Having a glioblastoma is incredibly rare. Only about 1 in 100,000 people have it. So I'm always looking for ways, I think, in my poetry to reach out and communicate by means of vehicles that are a little bit more common. For example, the eclipse became a vehicle for me to discuss what it's like living with a 14.6 median life expectancy. And I think that's something that all of us in the room experienced intimately, I hope. I think even though my diagnosis is rare, cancer is ubiquitous, and we all know people who have cancer or who have succumbed to cancer. I somehow felt that having my diagnosis gave me permission to talk about people in my life who have succumbed to cancer, who have been diagnosed with cancer, and one of those is the late and great Michelle Boisseau, professor of English at UMKC. And so I wrote this poem while in the English department there, while everybody else was at the funeral. Wish I had been at the funeral. Instead, I wrote this poem. It's called Poem Written During a Funeral Service. The English department's wired glass window is dark, a note tacked to the door. Closed for the services of Michelle Boisseau. Footsteps echo over the cracked and scuff-marked granite in which fluorescent bulbs represent themselves as watery triangles of light, their geometric perfection skewed, a failed mimesis in the mausoleum of art. The only sound is the whir of the leaf blower. A man is walking along the hedgerow. The wind he carries upends a mountain ridge of fallen leaves. Air erupts with the lava of leaves, an underwater volcano. Elephant grass undulates like anemone in the drowning sky. I hear a voice in the clouds. Kindergarteners or geese, I cannot tell. Classmates walk by with their heads down. I don't know why I felt like I had the liberty to pair that poem in this collection with the poem about my grandmother, who did not die of cancer, but who had Alzheimer's. But I'm gonna read this other poem about a very different matron in my memory. Grandma's baby grand. Charles' friend drags the dusting brush of his vacuum cleaner over the tuning pins below the lid of Grandma's baby grand, a 1929 Wurlitzer in which dust collects like ash from the smokestack of a crematorium. He pulls back the tennis ball handle of his tuning wrench like he's changing gears in a stick shift with one hand while pounding the one key with the other, like a migraine that the house is having. On the day that the moving van carrying her baby grand turned onto our cul-de-sac, Grandma told the driver he had the wrong address. He should take it back to Independence. Mr. Friend says every piano has its own unique set of overtones. Grandma could not remember burning the bacon or pouring her husband bowls of chicken soup congealed over weeks on the stovetop. She forgot about driving the wrong way down I-70, but I remember her liver-spotted hands on the keys playing my way until the sheets vanished, and then the notes, and then the lyrics.